Hey guys, this is David Kwan. By this point, I made 3 separate blogs on the topic of polygamy. And in my previous videos, I stated why I think polygamy shouldn't be legalized in the United States government. On this issue, I'm perfectly okay with the status quo, and moreover, I believe the status quo should be maintained. That is, I think it's okay if a person wants to have more than one sexual partner. But even so, I don't think such relationships should be legally recognized as marriages by the government. Polyamorous relationships should remain decriminalized as it is, but it's not something the state should encourage nor subsidize with legislation. That's currently how it is in the United States and also in many other developed countries, and I personally think it should remain that way. In my first video on this topic, I argued this without bringing any parallels to the gay marriage debate. That's because I wanted to emphasize the fact that these are different, separate debates. Should gay marriage be legalized? Should polygamy be legalized? The two debates have some commonality, sure. After all, they're both about marriages. But ultimately, the two debates have different, separate arguments for and against. I realize that many people who are against the legalization of gay marriage argue that legalization of gay marriage would redefine the concept of marriage. And from that point, once marriage is redefined, who's to say it can't be redefined again to legalize things like polygamy, things like incest, bestiality, pedophilia, oh no. But seriously, this slippery slope type of argument is bizarre and really not compelling at all. And there's a separate video where I tackle that also. People can argue against or argue for the legalization of polygamy without piggybacking off of arguments for or against legalization of gay marriage. It's a separate debate, and that's why in my very first video on this topic, I argued against the legalization of polygamy without even bringing up the gay marriage debate, without bringing any points about it. I talked about how jealousy and how in polyamorous relationship, marital jealousy is possible within the family unit. Whereas in monogamous relationship, jealousy always involves an external third party. This partly explains why rates of violence, things like rape, domestic violence, child abuse, or child molestation, homicide and suicide, all these things are statistically and almost always significantly higher among polygamous families than monogamous families. I then also briefly talked about how legalization of polygamy can possibly change the structure of society in a way that having more spouses would mean more prestige. That of course makes society even less egalitarian than it currently is, and I think that would be very harmful. By the second video, I realized that comparing the polygamy debate to the gay marriage debate can actually be helpful to make my argument. I mean, I stress again that they're separate debates, but it's important to bring the distinction. The key component of the gay marriage debate is the marriage equality argument. And this is what gay rights advocates argue, and they argue rightfully so, that homosexuality is a sexual orientation. And sexual orientation is an identity a person is born with, much like race, gender, nationality, physical appearance, and disability. These are identities that we're born with. There are, of course, things we consider as identity that we're not born with, such as religion and gender identity. But because such identities can so very much define who we are as individuals, these identities are nonetheless protected by the 14th Amendment. Well, sexual orientation and gender identity are currently not protected by the 14th Amendment, but they certainly should be. So that being the case, not allowing gay people or transsexual people to marry is discriminatory. That is the marriage equality argument, and I believe it's a very compelling argument in regards to homosexuality and gender identity. But trying to apply this argument to polygamy? First, how is polygamy an identity? Someone preferring to have more than one spouse is not a sexual orientation, and it's certainly not a gender identity. It'd be really extremely hard to argue that it's an identity that should be protected by the 14th Amendment. I mean, you could possibly try to fit it into being a part of one's religious identity, but that wouldn't work. Because religion as a federally protected class is about the belief system, not necessarily about the practices of the faith. And polygamy would be a practice. Polygamy is not an identity, and thus the marriage equality argument simply doesn't work at all, and thus the argument that somebody could make for the legalization of gay marriage can't be piggybacked off to make an argument for legalization of polygamy. Furthermore, the status quo is not necessarily discriminatory towards polygamous people. Not necessarily because they would still receive federal benefits and rights and benefits that come with marriage. After all, to have polygamy, you must first have monogamy. If you have monogamy, you get the rights and the benefits. For majority of gay people in this country, even with the Supreme Court striking down a significant part of DOMA, they will not be able to attain those benefits and those rights unless they decide to violate a part of their identity. And thus, the status quo is extremely discriminatory towards the LGBT couples. In my third video, I talked again about the rates of violence and how they're significantly higher among polyamorous and polygamous societies, compared to societies that do not legally endorse polygamy. This seems to be true currently and all throughout history. I, of course, am not, 100% confident enough to claim causality between violence and legalization of polygamy, but the correlation in almost all cases of comparison is so positively high that it simply cannot be ignored. I mean, sure, other societal factors could certainly better explain the rates of violence. Other factors such as poverty, the strength of religious indoctrination among the populace, discriminatory legislation, etc., all that kind of stuff. However, these factors are impossible to remove and isolate in case studies. And that being the case, the fact is that all things considered, monogamous societies simply have significantly lower rate of violence than polygamous societies. Lastly, I talked about how complex divorce would be in a polygamy. If polygamy is legalized, the only type of polygamy that should be legalized is a completely egalitarian one so that polygamy itself would not be sexist and discriminatory. Men should be able to have multiple wives, and at the same time, women should be able to have multiple husbands. If polygamy is ever legalized in the United States of America, both polygyny and polyandry should be accepted as legal forms of marriages. In fact, polygamy should go beyond even that and allow for really complex type of polygamies, such as one man marrying two women, and those two women marrying each other, and two other women. Really complex polygamy there. With all these complex types of polygamy legalized, I really end up wondering about divorce. I believe strongly that all married couples should be able to divorce. Divorce is a right that people should have if they have a right to marry, and they should be able to do so if they agree to do so. In a monogamy, divorce, I mean, at least in comparison to polygamy, is extremely simple. Two people want to discontinue their marriage for whatever reason, they get an attorney, and they try to find an agreement to divorce, and then they divorce. But in the complex polygamy where there are more than two people married to each other, divorce, I think, could and most likely will be extremely messy, and may also likely be a strong factor to increasing the risk of violence. Violence such as domestic abuse and homicide. So, that's a summary of all the three videos that I talked about. All these things I talked about in my previous three blogs. But, as is the case with me, as it turns out, there's still yet one other thing I want to bring up in regards to this topic. And I think I might end up surprising you in this video, because in this video, I want to bring up something that would actually be in favor of legalizing polygamy all this time. I've been arguing against the legalization of polygamy, but then here I come up with something that goes against my personal position. I mean, ultimately, my ultimate stance on this issue remains unchanged. I still personally think polygamy is something that the government should not subsidize. But, as is the case with almost all discussions and topics, the issue of whether or not polygamy should be legalized may be more complicated than I initially assumed it to be. See, the thing is that while countries like Canada, United States, Great Britain, Japan, and so on, they do not legally recognize polygamy. Still, there are many, many other countries in which polygamy, particularly polygyny, is legal and accepted. Every country has their own laws, sometimes similar, often very different. Saudi Arabia and Indonesia, for example, legally recognize polygamy, though the two countries have different legal regulations regarding polygamy. This being the case, I have to imagine, what if a polygamous family in Saudi Arabia end up immigrating to America? Now, their polygamy was legally recognized by the Saudi Arabian government. And with the current laws in place, that wouldn't matter in America. This family could be naturalized and become U.S. citizens, but even still, their polygamous marriage would not be legally recognized by the United States government. And it's these kind of instances that really trouble me. I mean, in these instances, the current stance held by the American government does actually feel discriminatory to me. Here's this man with three wives. You know, he comes from Saudi Arabia. And he's sure to have many kids through those wives. In his home country, all three women would be legally recognized as his wives. But now, he comes to America, and that's not the case. He has to choose one of his wives to be legally recognized. But the other two wives would be the undocumented wives. Now, even in these extraordinary instances, I would still hold the view that marriage equality argument cannot be used to support the legalization of polygamy. Even in these instances, it would be perfectly constitutional. I have no doubt about that. My doubt is much weaker than that. I just doubt, is this fair? Is it fair that marriages that were previously recognized no longer count because they moved to a different country? In these instances, is the status quo correct? And honestly, I'm not sure. All other arguments I've made against legalization of polygamy, I felt pretty damn sure. But this is definitely one point that has me quite perplexed. Ultimately, I of course think polygamy should not be legalized, but I'm now starting to wonder if certain exceptions could possibly be allowed.